This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, today we have a guest on Dreamland who has been on with us off and on since 2010, but has not been on since 2017, which amazed me because Rich Dolan is so present in this field and such a major contributor. You listen to him on his own terrific show, or you listen to him on other shows, and you think, well, wait a minute, haven't I had him on my show surely in the past 6 months or year? But I hadn't. And so here he is again, Richard Dolan, and I'm very glad you can be with us. He is one of the leading thinkers in the UFO subject, starting with UFOs and the national security state, which we interviewed him about in 2010. He offers original analysis. He really is an absolute original and a highly skilled researcher. And he has got a new book out called The Alien Agendas, Speculative Analysis of Those Visiting Earth. We're going to be talking about a little later. So much has happened recently, and so much is happening, that I thought we would start out by talking about what we've been doing recently. We were involved in a documentary together with Linda Moulton Howe and William Henry and a number of others, which presumably will be starting to appear in September, October. We were at the Making Contact conference together. We both had presentations, and we were on a panel together with Eric Weinstein, Mark Sims, and some others. Eric Weinstein is a mathematician who just recently sort of changed his stripes from being a UFO skeptic to being sort of interested. And I say sort of interested because I feel like, as I am also meeting the people who are just getting into this from a different level in the culture. In other words, this man Eric Weinstein is a mathematician and not at all the sort of person who you would think would be accepting this possibility. And he's having some trouble doing it, I think. And I think his problems are going to be reflected more and more in the wider community. For example, Richard, what do you think about, not Eric in particular, but when people at his level, scientists, mathematicians, intellectuals in general, come up against the ultra high strangeness that we live with every day? What happens?
Yeah, the thing that it's very easy for even brilliant people to forget or not to know is what a steep learning curve the entire phenomenon of UFOs and extraterrestrials or whoever these visitors or others are. That's a steep, steep learning curve. And I remember my own experience back in the 1990s. I got into this quite a bit later than you did, Whitley. About 10 years later, actually. I had a very naive, fond idea that once I became interested in this subject, I would need 2 or 3 months to figure it out and then move on.
All right.
And that it doesn't work like that. The UFO subject, I liken it to to something like a Zen master living in a deep cave up in a mountain. And when you go to visit a master like that, what you don't do is walk in there and demand to know everything all at once. It doesn't work like that. It's a long, long process. And actually, the UFO subject is such a Zen master. It's a teacher. And the way to learn is by being humble before the phenomenon, because it is, as you just said, it's much stranger than we tend to realize. And the highly educated folks, I think in a lot of ways, they have additional problems because, you know, you go through your life, you develop your worldview, you have social status in connection with that worldview. And, you know, we all like to think that we can separate our world of ideas from the larger social situation we find ourselves in. I don't think that's really easy to do. There's so much pressure in the academic and in the established intellectual world to regard UFOs as a silly subject. So there's a real hesitancy that I think very ultra well-educated people will often have when they confront the UFO subject. And, you know, with respect to Eric Weinstein, who's obviously a brilliant man, but I, like you, when we did our panel with him, I just felt that he was very frustrated by the subject in many ways. But I think ultimately the frustration stemmed from, you know, him, like all of us in the beginning, wanting to keep the UFO subject in a nice little box that makes sense.
Right.
And it just doesn't. It just doesn't.
It doesn't make sense. And in fact, the closer you get to it, the less sense it makes. And the more certain you become that it's somehow real, the less clear it becomes as to what that how means.
And I'll add one other thing here. Whatever the reality is, and you think about this all the time, and so do I, like, what is the actual boots on the ground reality of this phenomenon? In other words, who are we dealing with? What are their agendas? And how is that relating to our society at large? These are very deep questions. And whatever the truth is, this is something that as a society, we haven't even started to scratch the surface. You know, we've talked about a greater openness in our public discussion of UFOs since 2017. Yes, that's true. But we're at the most baby steps of all. We're at the point where we now finally have an admission. Well, there's something out there and we don't know what it is. But my God, like, the actual reality is so vastly deeper than that. And that includes what I've said for years is a cover up of the deepest levels. And that says nothing about the nature of these other beings. And those are things when someone is starting into this field, it takes time to graduate to those types of questions and really deal with them in a meaningful way. And I think so that frustration that we saw with Eric Weinstein, I think it was reflective of that reality.
Yeah, I do too. And I think also that the shambolic nature of the community and what it has to offer in terms of explanations and even research is going to be very difficult for them to understand, because what you basically have here are hundreds of people, many of them really skilled. Most of them have learned those skills on the fly in the process of exploring these mysteries. But what you don't have is anything that reflects the established routines of science in the academy, with very, very few exceptions. And so the result of this is that, and then you have this apparently large hidden world, which you and I know enough about to know is in fact large and is in fact hidden. But then when these people asked, well, how can I meet somebody who's connected with this world? All we have to offer are people like Jacques Vallée and Hal Puthoff, who are sort of connected with it, but they're not deep insiders. And, right. I wouldn't say that even if I had such information about such people, I would not be willing to share it.
Because yeah, exactly.
They're behind a very serious wall of security.
His again, with Weinstein, his biggest criticism, as I saw it anyway, during our panel with him, which was for 2 hours, was it wasn't really even directed against the phenomenon itself. I thought it was more like none of the way the government is handling this makes sense. They don't have their best and brightest looking at this. I know who the best and brightest are, and none of them, to my knowledge, are involved in this. So we need our smartest people to look into this. Okay, fine. We certainly would all benefit from having a much broader range of brilliant people studying this. I think we can all agree. I said one thing to him, and I wish I had said a second thing. What I said in response was, well, that is probably true, but, you know, I think security is probably more important to these people running the program, even than figuring it out scientifically. I think this is at least possible. The other thing I should have mentioned, I wish I had thought of it at the time, was I was going to say, well, probably some of the people you know might be in the program, but there's no way they could ever tell you. Never.
No.
When you're involved in studying this phenomenon in the special access program in any capacity, you are not allowed to talk about it at all. We all know this. And even a no comment is not permissible. You've got to actively deny. That's the way these programs work.
That's what's so important to understand, folks. They are legally required to lie in order to cover things up.
Yeah. I didn't think to say that. I wish I had.
What?
I didn't think to say that in the moment when we were doing it. I wish I had thought of it.
And you wish you had. Yeah, that's right. Because it has to be remembered. And some of these people really are read in, like Hal Pudoff. It's probably read in a lot of ways. And you have to really know Hal well in order to even have a meaningful conversation with him. And then you can't know for certain where you stand because of that requirement.
I've known him for a little over 20 years. Well, by the way, I want to remind you, you actually were the first person ever to interview me. And it was in October of 2000.
On Dreamland in October.
That's right.
Of 2000.
Yeah, you did.
Wow.
And,
I wish I had those old shows, but Clear Channel didn't keep them.
I have a copy of that interview. I found it. I had it saved. I can get it to you.
Get it to me if you can.
It was a lot of fun. I was nervous as hell. I can tell you that. I was terrified.
Probably
you were great.
Was too.
You were wonderful. But as far as with Hal Pudoff, I've known him that long also. And, you know, I like to think that I have a good relationship with him. We respect each other. We've had some personal conversations from time to time. And we've talked off the record on a number of things, but my goodness, he is famous for playing his cards very close to his chest. He doesn't give up anything that he does not want to give up. And I have at times tried to pry every little tidbit out, and I get what he's willing to give me, and that's it. Nothing more.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, I knew other people in my Uncle Mickey died with his secrets. I think the more I delve into my own past, I'm pretty sure my father was involved in some way. He certainly died with his secrets.
It's incredible.
General Exon died with most of his secrets, although he was much more forthcoming than the others until he slipped up and talked to people who then published his stuff, and then he was silenced. So, you know, the reason for all of this secrecy is very complex, and I want to delve into your ideas about it, because I know that we always look at the government and its decisions, and we need it to disclose to us. But what if there's another locomotion back there, someone in the visitor level of things that's controlling this? How do you respond to that thought?
Well, I've been thinking more and more and more about this as the years go by. To what extent is there control? And the first thing I would say is that it would be irresponsible to rule it out. And secondly, I think it's an entire possibility. But and I'd like to return to that, but I would just say on the purely human scale of it, in terms of the birth of the secrecy of UFOs, one thing that I don't think any of us have really determined for sure is when did the first modern government really become aware of this? You know, you've got, I was just, you know, become aware of the research of Roberto Pinotti in Italy on the very possible UFO crash in 1933 in Italy. And I don't think that's a bad case at all. I think it's entirely possible. In the United States, we've got at least a reasonable case for the 1941 event at Cape Girardeau in Missouri, which as years go by, I think is a probable UFO crash event as well. So that's many years before Roswell. But however we want to look at it, at some point during the 1940s, the United States government became aware of this. And I've often tried to put myself in the position of whether it's Harry Truman or even FDR, like how would a president respond to the news from his military? Like if it's a crash retrieval, so the military, from what we know of the Cape Girardeau event, we don't have as much data, but U.S. military was there and did silence people. And then with Roswell, of course, we know that story much better. So let's say the president becomes aware of it from his leading military people. I mean, what would a U.S. president really do if his top general or intelligence director says, "Sir, we've recovered technology that doesn't appear to come from this civilization. And by the way, a couple of bodies that are not human." That's a heavy thing to lay on any president. And I have a hard time seeing a U.S. president just making that announcement to the world, because there's just too many variables. A, you don't know who these beings are, friend or foe. Like, you want to get your facts straight. B, you've got technology and you have geopolitical enemies out there or adversaries. Do you want the world to know that you've got this incredible technology? In 1947, as I've often said, the U.S. wasn't even willing to share atomic technology with the world. I can't imagine how in God's name they would want to share something as exotic as alien tech. So there would be a lot of genuine reasons, understandable reasons anyway, to initiate at least a provisional secrecy. You know, president might say to his team, "We got to get this together. We have to figure out what's going on. And who are these guys and what's their capabilities? What are they doing here?" And meanwhile, you have to control the media. You got to keep them compliant. You are going to be the guard dog in the academic world. We have to maintain and manage the conversation. I think that would be paramount. So I think that's how the secrecy starts. And then, of course, if there's any technology, you've got to get that to the right people to study it. You can get the lawyers involved. Like, who owns the tech if the Army gets it to Lockheed? You have to figure out all of these things. And so you've got a network and structure of secrecy that's developed right away. And it could very well be, and I don't know, but the original decision for secrecy might have been provisional, might have been, we'll revisit this in 5 years and decide what we want to do. But I think what happens with a secret like this is it's just, there's never a good time to reveal it. It's always something you want to kick that can down the road. And next thing you know, 75 years go by and here we are. We've got an entire institutional structure of secrecy and lies that have done tremendous damage to our political institutions, for one. And I think psychological damage as well to our society. You know, when you have got people unable, you know, someone who has an encounter, whether it's with an actual being or even a dramatic UFO encounter, it's usually the most intense experience of their life. And who do they have to talk about it with? Basically no one, because there's a culture of secrecy and ridicule that's in place. And so it's not a healthy way to deal with this. You know, we're all atomized in the process. So it becomes a very unhealthy thing. But I think that's how the secrecy started, with this need, perceived need to get on top of this. And the other thing that I've wondered, and I've heard a number of other people make this argument too, I'm not the only one, but that implicit in any genuine UFO disclosure, I think ultimately would probably be a transition in our energy paradigm. So I just think even a 10-year-old kid looking at an object that can instantly accelerate or zigzag or whatever, it's probably realizes it's not using gasoline to go from here to there. So it's got to be a different source of energy. And if the world is apprised of this, if people are told about this, That means you've got a lot of brilliant scientists now who realize there is a post-petroleum energy solution. I think half the battle in getting to a breakthrough is just realizing that it's even possible. And so I think that would very likely spur energy research and maybe even leaks that might give some indications of a post-petroleum world. That might be great for a lot of us, but it would be a highly disruptive thing, particularly for U.S. strength and policy worldwide. U.S., especially since the 70s, it lives on what's called the petroleum dollar, controlling oil in the Middle East, forcing other nations to use the dollar as their method of transaction. And, you know, you lose petroleum as the main source of energy, that just throws everything to hell there. So there's a lot of reasons that you can see the structure of power thinking, we're going to hold on to this one. And I think as years go by, they're just going to hold on to it tighter than ever. I don't, by the way, think that we're in a true disclosure era. I think that there's a tremendous force of secrecy that still remains.
I agree with you entirely. And free Dreamlanders, it's time to take a little break, enjoy these commercials, and above all, do what we say. We'll be right back. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia. Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started.
Unknown Country and Dreamland are unique in every way. The site offers over 16,000 news stories dating back 20 years, all of them with our uniquely open-minded and yet carefully researched point of view. You can find stories of everything from lost cities to multiple witness high strangeness events to the cutting edge of science and reality on the site. For subscribers, the site offers a wealth of material that is mind-opening and can be life-changing. Plus, there are active comment sections, both in the free area and the subscriber area, and a free weekly newsletter. Dreamland, which Whitley Strieber has been hosting for over 20 years, is archived on the site back to 2004. This archive is the only one of its kind in the world, an incredible richness of information that offers exciting adventure every time you dig in. So go to unknowncountry.com daily, get our newsletter, participate in the site's social groups, and above all, subscribe and join this unique community today. Go to unknowncountry.com and click on the Subscribe tab to see our options.
We're talking to Richard Dolan, his website, richarddolanmembers.com, where you can get all kinds of great stuff, such as complete access to his podcast. He operates in the same extremely annoying system I do, which is you don't get everything unless you pay. There's an awful lot there of value. And as you can hear from what Richard is saying, his opinions and thoughts are valuable. He's a highly literate, capable intellectual who has, thank God, taken an interest in this field. And there's not all that many of them around. A lot of people in the field are perhaps less careful than Richard, or less thoughtful in some ways. But with Richard, you can always count on that careful, thoughtful approach. And he also has a tendency to break stories every once in a while before anyone else, which is a lot.
Every now and then, not too often, but once in a while.
It has happened before. So don't miss RichardDolanMembers.com and the alien agendas, which we're going to be talking about in just a minute. Now, we brushed up on the idea that there could be another level of control. And being, well, like, I'll give you an example of why I'm concerned, that concerns me so much. Yesterday, the day after the Making Contact conference, it's one of the strangest days I've had in a long time. Now, I can't tell you why. I can only tell you that apparently I had, during the course of the day, at least two significant missing time experiences in broad daylight. Now, I've had those before. Recently, there have been quite a few. And folks, if you've never heard of missing time, it is a period of time that simply doesn't exist for you. So the result was, it was 9:30 yesterday morning. Then it was noon. Then I had my lunch and did the Zoom meeting and a couple of other things. And then it was 7:15. End of day. End of day.
Wow.
So, yeah. So what was going on? I think that somebody wanted to know everything I had to offer about that conference, because I think the conference was important to them. But to what degree are we involved? Because if it had been two 10-minute missing time experiences in which I had perhaps been given suggestions about what I was to do and think and talk, I wouldn't have even known it. How much of that could be going on in this world? In other words, there could be a penetration at a level that we don't expect at all. And maybe someone is behind the scenes is in much more control of what the insiders think and do than they themselves realize.
My goodness, I hate that thought, but...
Me too.
In your case, I mean, you had several hours of missing time, not even 10-minute slots. That's quite substantial. It reminds me of that movie, The Adjustment Bureau, you know, where you got these people going in behind the scenes and moving.
Right.
I've often entertained these ideas as well. Like, are we just characters like in a video game? And someone says, all right, I've got Strieber for the next 5 years. I'm going to manage him. You take Dolan and you take this person and we'll move them around the board the way we want to. Like, I'm hoping that's not the case. Usually I don't think it is, but sometimes I have wondered. The thing is with UFOs, again, that to me, that was my gateway into the world of the weird. It could have been any number of other things, I suppose. But to your point about control, one of the things that I have become very interested in, and I know you must be, because I recall your... many years ago when you wrote your book, The Key, which actually you and I talked about before you published it, you had a very human man appear at your hotel and gave you one hell of a download of information. My goodness. But there are so many accounts that I have received over the years as well, and others that I've just read and researched, of entirely human-looking individuals that seem to be operating on another level.
We're sort of leading now into alien agendas, folks,
because
there's a lot of this material that I was going to get to, and we've gotten to it. So let's go. That's great. Just keep right on.
Well, yeah. So thank you. And by the way, thank you for that nice plug of my website. I appreciate that.
Sure thing.
I resisted this whole line of looking at human-looking aliens for the longest time, because, you know, I realized when I started years ago, I wanted all the aliens to behave into like one typology, gray aliens. That's all they were supposed to be. I just thought anything more than that is confusing. I mean, I don't think that I explicitly told myself you're not going to look at anything else. But I do think at a subconscious level, I wanted to operate like that. So I had a tendency, especially in the earlier years, to not pay as much attention to accounts of totally human looking beings. Or I didn't try to think it through. Like, what did that mean? What did that mean?
Yeah, I was sort of put off by the whole 1950, yeah. mid-50s Venusians, beautiful yeah, Venusians thing. Maybe shouldn't have been.
I think that was it with me too, maybe. Yeah, I think so.
Go ahead.
So I'd had this bias against it, I suppose. But the problem was when you just get so many accounts. My God, I remember talking with Linda Moulton Howe years ago. She personally, I don't know if she's mentioned this above, she's had encounters with very like bizarre human looking beings who just do not seem right.
So have I have them all the time.
Yeah. Yeah. You
have lots of them.
Tim Good talked about one such encounter with this kind of a telepathic being. I've spoken with a number of other witnesses who told me of these super gorgeous blonde male female couples dressed in beautiful blue clothing who got inside their heads. One was a 15-year-old girl in church back in 1965 in Pennsylvania. And she told me, in front of her in this tiny little town where she grew up, where everyone knew everyone, especially in church, this couple that no one had ever seen before, supermodel quality in the most amazing blue clothing. So they're sitting in front of this 15-year-old girl. She was 60 now when she told me the story. She was amazed by them. She said, "My God, like, they're movie stars. No one's looking at them. Why is no one looking at them?" And she said to me, and that's when I heard them in my mind. And what she heard was one apparently thinking to the other something like, "Well, we appear to be fitting in pretty well here." And then she heard the other one think back, "Yes, except for the girl behind us who can hear us." And after that, they shut it down. She couldn't hear anything else. This was a Catholic mass. When that ended, they bolted out of the church. And she, this is almost hilarious, she decides to chase after them. And her mother, oblivious, is like, "Get back here, young lady." But so she goes through the crowd. She's chasing this couple. And she's at the front of the church. She sees them. They're across the parking lot. They've gone over this hill. And she goes after them. And they're now down in this grassy area walking toward a wooded area. And she starts down the hill and then stopped because she saw a third person. She said, "Remember Lurch from the Addams Family? He looked just like that guy." So very tall, like a man in black suit, black hat, intimidated her, frightened her. So she didn't go any further. And this couple walked by him into the woods. He turned around and followed them into the woods. And that was her whole story. I got a similar story about these blonde supermodel types from a retired colonel, PhD, with his wife. They both told me the story. They were in a Las Vegas casino with a friend of theirs. And I'll make it short, but basically they encountered a similar type of blonde couple that they were absolutely, he heard them in his mind. Same type of thing. And they went off and that was the end of them. I've encountered a few other of these types of stories directly. And so my point is simply, I've had to recognize there are people who look just like us, but they're not like us. Now, I don't know what they are, but when I wrote the Alien Agendas a year ago, the reason I wanted to approach that book is it was a different kind of an exploration for me. I decided I've been studying this subject long enough, and I do tend to be very conservative. I try to be anyway with my conclusions. But I thought I'd like to decide for myself what I personally believe is going on. So who are these other beings? So for that end, I wanted to go through the long history of apparent encounters. Let's put it that way. And when you go back through the centuries, it's not like you're reading a MUFON report. There's no investigators. You just get stories. But some of them are interesting. Some of them seemed credible enough to me that I included them. And my general conclusion was that human-looking operatives have been doing a low-level monitoring of us for millennia, at least for many, many centuries, and I think millennia. I even wondered if we were genetically modified 40, 45,000 years ago, and I actually put that idea out there.
Yeah, but that's one of the most interesting parts of the book. And if you want to digress for a moment, let's talk about that.
By all means. Because,
go ahead.
Yeah, I have a friend who, she's deceased. She was a PhD, taught at two universities here in Rochester, New York. She taught at the University of Rochester and Rochester Institute of Technology. They're both very fine schools. Her name was Colleen Clements. Colleen was a really an extraordinary lady. I cared very much for her. And she had a couple of areas where she studied a lot, where she was good. But her interest toward the end of her life was in understanding potential genetic modifications of the human species about 45,000 years ago. And she got into research. Now, she died in 2008 or 2009, 2010. But anyway, her last book was in 08. And she got into research that talked about an allele that is a part of our genomic structure known as the microcephalin gene. And there's a particular variation that we now have. It's called an allele. Alleles are just variations. That is very significant for human brain development, brain growth. And we only receive this. We don't really have an exact time frame as to when we got it. It's a kind of a guesstimate. You know, I mean, generally speaking, it's around 40,000 years ago. And the thing about this gene, all the geneticists apparently are agreed, it could only have come from outside our species. Now, I don't know why they say this, but this is what they all seem to agree on. So,
in other words, it could have come from the Neanderthals or the Denisovians?
Well, that would be the leading candidate, yes. Now, when she wrote that book, that was just before we learned about the Denisovans. Yeah. So she wasn't including them. They're closely related to Neanderthals, however. But what she did say is that if we were going to interbreed, then we want to be able to find that genetic evidence in the Neanderthals. They were the leading candidate. And at the time of her writing, there was no evidence whatsoever that the Neanderthals had this gene. Her conclusion, provisional conclusion, was she said, look, if we can't find this gene in the Neanderthal structure, in their genomic structure, then we have to ask a hard question of who's the daddy here. And if there are no other candidates, then maybe we want to look elsewhere. And the other thing that she studied was the history of human mythology. And she was really quite good with that, actually. I learned in talking with her, and she wrote about this. Her long story short, her analysis pointed that in what she believed is the origins of some of the earliest human mythological stories of sky gods, as well as the gene structure, that she looked at basically Central Asia as the place where this interbreeding began. There are certain sky god stories that you get in the Mongol culture that we don't know how old they are because we didn't have writing, but they appear to be some of our earliest sky god stories. And her hypothesis was that a lot of these sky god stories had originated from there. We do know that in terms of the microcephalin gene that humanity has, not all human beings have it, but it radiates out from Mongolia and the Yakutsk region in Russia. So you've got, that's like 99-100% of the people, and then it moves out from there to a lesser amount. So fast forward more than a decade, and I'm thinking about wanting to figure out, what do I think about the alien presence here? And however it was, I just remembered Colleen's work. So the first thing I wanted to do was find out, well, did we discover if the Neanderthals or now the Denisovans have this gene? And I went through all the academic scientific papers I could find on it. And the answer is no, they do not have it. And it's not for lack of trying, because the people studying this, they are well aware. We've got the gene and they don't. And so you can read in these papers, the researchers wanted desperately to find the microcephalin gene in the Neanderthals. And it just doesn't look like it's there, Whitley. It just doesn't. The Denisovans, we have much less genetic evidence for them, unfortunately. But we do know they are very closely related to the Neanderthals. And it doesn't look, frankly, like they are the source either. So if they're not the source, I just carried on Colleen's argument. And I thought, is it possible? You know, you can envision humanity. I'm a very avid student of human prehistory. I actually am deeply engaged in that, and I love studying it. And if you were to imagine an extraterrestrial species or some other species observing humans, say 45, 50,000 years ago, you could see them thinking, they are very close. These are very clever beings, these humans. Let's do a little something for them. Let's tweak them a little bit. And, you know, the theory is, were we genetically enhanced by them? And if that's the case, just as Charles Fort 100 years ago wondered, are we someone's project? Are we property? Or are we just someone's beneficent, benign project? I don't know. But anyway, that's where I started. And what I would say after that is that over the many centuries, there have been at least a few decent stories, accounts of people who have encountered what certainly appear to be beings. They look like us, but they don't seem to be from where we are. And so I think that we've been in a low-level monitoring process. I'll just finish my thought here. What I also believe is that, because I incorporated a theory into this book, and I call it the fourth stage of humanity. And to me, this actually, to my satisfaction, explains why I think other beings are here. So we've gone through three full stages of human development. In my view, there's only three ways that we've ever lived for hundreds of thousands of years as hunter-gatherers for most of our time, frankly. And then a little less than 10,000 years ago, we developed agriculture and towns and cities and writing and the wheel and metallurgy, like all the things that give us civilization, everything from ancient Egypt to the Italian Renaissance. And then that's stage two. So then stage three is science and industry, which we just developed a few centuries ago. And that transformed us yet again. And now I think we're moving to a fourth stage where it's qualitatively going to be different. And maybe we can call it the transhuman stage. That might be the best word for it. But it's a combination of more than just genetic manipulation. It's complete data analysis and data hoovering, data vacuuming of the entire world, and 5G and artificial intelligence and complete monitoring and surveillance. What I sometimes think of as turning humanity into a big giant anthill. And I think we're moving toward that. And I think that's what's getting everyone's attention out beyond our community, because I think, although it will probably diminish our individual power and sovereignty, it will make us collectively very, very powerful, very powerful. So, and I think it's at that point, sometime in the last century, when that transition was clearly would be visible to someone else, that we started getting other visitors, other beings, the grays or the mantids or insectoids, I think would be first front row center of those visiting groups. Maybe reptilian beings as well. So I think we started getting the attention of other groups at that time.
Well, you know, in the grays, I haven't heard too much about other forms being interested in abduction and in particular the removal of sexual material and so forth. When I had that experience, it was with the grays and also these dark blue troll-like figures, which I've come to suspect have much more to do with us than it seems obvious. I'm not sure they're aliens at all. I think they might be from here also, but not the grays. I don't think the grays are from here.
I tend to agree with you. And I'll just add, I think the human-looking contingent, let's say, my speculation, and it's only a speculation, could be an alien species might have taken their own supply of native humans and used them as their avatars or as their workforce to do the monitoring. It would be a lot more rational, first of all, make more sense. But I think that over time, would it be possible that such a human group would be so different from us, like culturally and also through genetic modifications, possibly we might have very little in common with them in certain ways.
Well, you know, that seems like a logical. So it's so logical that you'd think it almost must have happened. And when you look at this gene and you look back 40,000 years, and when I was reading your book, I was also aware of another book called The Cycle of Cosmic Catastrophes, which is about something primarily about something that happened 12,000 years ago that instituted the Younger Dryas and the whole upheaval that led to the essentially the collapse of the entire ecosystem, the extinction of the mammoths and the disappearance of essentially all human life in North America, et cetera. That's a well-known geologic fact, and it's been extensively studied on many different levels, geology, paleontology, archaeology, et cetera. But he points out in the book that about 40,000 years ago, there was a supernova that irradiated a strip of the Earth, which included much of Australia, and it caused the extinction of all of the large marsupials that were there at the time.
Okay.
And the reason was they couldn't hide from it. The smaller animals went into burrows and the human beings that were there hid because they saw this gigantic extra sun in the sky and they scared them and they hid in caves. But the big animals, the big massive marsupials all died out because they were irradiated with gamma radiation.
Interesting.
Now, at that time, something big was going on, and the human species probably took a tremendous hit. Probably there was a significant population decline around the world simply because of the violence of what had happened. Could it be that that was when somebody decided, well, wait a minute, this species was coming along beautifully. We need to intervene to give them enough intelligence to survive.
That's interesting.
I mean, it seems logical to me.
Yeah, it's not. That's an interesting idea. That could be true. I haven't heard that before, so I think that's quite intriguing. One thing that's definitely obvious, I think most people listening are aware, that it was about 40,000 years ago that you see a true creative explosion in among human beings.
Well, that's one of the most fascinating parts of your book. And folks, I just want to, since we're not going to take a second commercial break, I want to remind you now, go to richarddolanmembers.com and get involved. You have to be involved in this. And yes, it may take you spending money on more than one subscription, but there's nothing more important going on in the world. So do it, get involved and listen, but go ahead.
Well, thank you, Whitley. I'll add there's, I have a lot, probably like you, I have a lot of free content that people can just peruse if they want. But yeah, our creativity just went parabolic at around 40,000 years ago.
Exactly.
Even among earlier humans, forget the Neanderthals who were there at the time as well, but earlier human cultures had some artwork, but it's, and I'm not trying to diminish any of it, but it's not anywhere close to the level that you start seeing with these incredible cave paintings and sculptures. And also not just art, but music. We started seeing some of the earliest musical instruments around that time and a tremendous development. I'm not sure how much I got into this, but in tool making and tool like the great, great creative expansion in the kinds of tools and weapons that people use to hunt and so on. Sewing and so much more. So you really start seeing a piling on of one creative development after another. So a lot of things seem to coalesce at around 40 to 45,000 years ago. And that supernova, yeah, I would be intrigued by that. And I wonder if that could be a contributor to it.
You know, when you look at that cave art, that for example, the art at Chauvet-Pont d'Arc in France, 37,000 years old, and it is highly sophisticated. It's not just the early attempts of someone to draw. It is someone with extraordinary skill, not only in terms of art, but in their ability to place the art in such a way that it uses the natural formation in the cave to give the creatures that are being depicted substance and form. I mean, you know, they looked at the rocks and built the creature, drew the creatures around the rocks in such a way that their bodies would have three dimensions and so forth and so on. But here's the most bizarre thing. It's very dark back in those caves, but there are no indications of any, for example, any soot from torches. So how in the world did they do that?
That's a good question. You know, it's interesting. Pablo Picasso visited one of those caves and examined the art. Back in the early years, like, it was a lot easier for people to get access to those. And when he came out, he said something like, "We have gained nothing on those ancestors. Like, we invented nothing. They invented it." I think he was blown away by the quality of the artistic work and how they did it. I didn't realize the lack of soot from torch. You'd have to have torches there for light, because it's pitch black otherwise.
I know. You had to have some kind of light, or who knows? It's just such a mystery. But the greater mystery is, I'm pretty sure about the torches comment, but I'm not certain that's true in all of the caves. I'm pretty sure it's true at Chauvet.
Interesting.
But even if it isn't, even if they did have torches, that doesn't change the extraordinary skill that was involved. And when you look at the work, you can see that there's it's not labor. In other words, there's no one slowly, carefully etching along. This was drawn with ease and skill by someone who was very confident in their ability. It has the look of confident art that's unmistakable.
Yeah, and you think about it, it's not like you can just take an eraser, and if you make a mistake, I'd have to think that would be a difficult process. So, like, it's almost like doing a fresco. You know, it goes up there and it's done. Don't screw it up. So there's like this risk involved in any kind of great art creation, because you can easily screw it up. And you're so right. There's this, I hadn't thought about it, but this ease, this confidence in being able to master what they were portraying. And they did it. They nailed it.
They did it. They nailed it. Now, free Dreamlanders, I've got some very bad news for you. And good news basically for nobody. You have to leave now. And I want you to subscribe to my show. I ask you every week. And about, I think, a little under 2% of you actually do subscribe. And I'm grateful for that 2%, believe me, because the rest of you wouldn't be here either if it wasn't for them. So subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Go to Richard Dolan membership, members.com. Find and do the same thing you do on my website. Dig around for all the free stuff. But then take another step. Get into this. It's not expensive. Richard's is $7 a month. Mine's $5 a month. These things aren't costly, but they are so valuable, because there will come a time when Richard and I are both bones in the ground, and probably most of you are too, when these websites are going to be in historical archives, assuming we still exist, which who knows whether that will be the truth or not. But they're important. They're valuable. So respect that, please, and help us. Free Dreamlanders, subscribers, we're just going to keep on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.